Is that working? Look at all those phones and cameras. Hi. and I'm going to drop this here. So welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. And of course, in the beautiful Berkeley Institute for Data Science, thank you, Kevin Coy, for having us. And welcome. Welcome, everyone, also afar in the interwebs. Hi. Bienvenidos y bienvenidas. Before we start this interesting, very interesting colloquium, as curator and coordinator of the show, No Legacy, Literatura, Electrónica, which we're celebrating today, I would like to give some special thank yous. And the list is long, so bear with me. First, to my fantastic team, it was a big team effort, my co-curator, Élika Ortega, who will speak to you in a minute, Claude Potts, our special curator for print objects, because No Legacy has 16 digital installations and 50-plus experimental print works, so go check it out. Stephanie Lee, our lead exhibition designer, Aisha Hamilton, our library exhibition design liaison, Cody Hennessy, coordinator for digital works, Cristina Sa, consultant for Portuguese, and I hope she's in Porto looking at David Wong, lead for computer infrastructure support, as well as the many, many students from the BCNM and New Media Studies that had helped us with the design of the show. Grace, Keenan, Deira Marin, Michael, Anna, Madeline, Lingyu, Yipu, Alexandra, and our student docent, Sam Honeycutt. Of course, nothing could have been done without the support of our generous sponsors. So big, big thanks, de corazón, to, and again, long list, the University Library. Thanks, Eric Mitchell, Beth Dupois, but also Sujik Johal, Jeffrey Johnson, and Kate Tasker from the Bancroft. So thank you, Bancroft. The Berkeley Center for New Media. Thank you, Greg Niemeyer and Lara. The Hellman Foundation, the Spanish and Portuguese Department, the Townsend Center for the Humanities, the College of Letters and Science, special thank you to our dean, Tony Cascardi, the Digital Humanities at Berkeley, thanks Claudia Bombacano, the Institute of European Studies, thanks so much Jerome DeWolf, the Portuguese Studies Program, the Center for Latin American Studies, our friends in the fabrication shops at the College of Environmental Design, the Institute for Digital Research in the Humanities at the University of Kansas, and many, many more that have helped us throughout. We couldn't have done it without you. I also would like to remind you that as part of today's opening and after these roundtable discussions in the morning at 5:30 in the Morrison Library, which is right across the hall, we will have two readings by two of our showcase artists in the show, Amaranth Borsuk and Domenico Chape. So please check that out. Come and join us for a tour of the exhibit and a glass of wine or two. So without further delay, I would like to introduce our first panel or roundtable discussion, Electronic Literature, History, Archaeology, Artifacts, with Dene Grigar, Roberto Cruz Arzabal, and Élika Ortega. Élika will be double deeping today as speaker and moderator. We're very efficient here. So I'll introduce her first, and then she'll move on. Apart from being co-curator of this show with me, Élika is a postdoctoral researcher at the Institute for Digital Research at the University of Kansas, where she teaches courses on digital humanities. She writes about digital literature, not necessarily digital media, intermediality, materiality, reading practices and interfaces, books, networks, and multilingualism in academia. She co-directs the DH seminar at the Hall Center for the Humanities at KU. She's part of the Executive Committee of Global Outlook Digital Humanities and Executive Council Officer for the Association of Computers in the Humanities. She also writes for Red HD and Geom. And I guess I've been talking forever now, so I'll leave it to her to present the rest of our speakers.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for the introduction, Alex. I want to echo all of the thank yous that you've already done. This has been really an amazing couple of years of planning and working through the exhibit, and none of it would have been possible without the bigger and smaller and all size contributions that everybody has done. Thank you so much to all our guests, too, for agreeing to come here. We're really thrilled to have you here. As Alex said, our first roundtable is going to be dealing on history, archaeology, and artifacts. Basically, at the exhibit, we have two conceptual threads And one has to do with the materiality of the works, and the other one has to do with transnational and translinguistic and trans, what's the other approach? the other title? Transatlantic, yes, thank you very much. So the first one will deal with the history, archaeology, and artifacts. And I am really, really honored to present Dene Grigar as one of our speakers here. She is a professor and director of the Creative Media and Digital Culture Program at Washington State University, Vancouver. Her research focuses on the creation, curation, preservation, and criticism of electronic literature. She has authored 14 media works, such as Curlew, 2014, A Villager's Tale, 2011, the 24-hour micro-elite project, 2009, When Ghosts Will Die, 2008, and Fallow Field, a story in two parts in 2005, as well as 52 scholarly articles. She also curates exhibits of electronic literature and media art, mounting shows at the Library of Congress, and for the International Symposium on Electronic Art and the Modern Languages Association, among other venues. With Stuart Mountrop, professor at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, she is the recipient of a 2013 NEH startup grant for a digital preservation project for early electronic literature that culminated into an open source multimedia book for scholars entitled Pathfinders, and a book of criticism entitled Traversals. So keep an eye out for those. Our second speaker after is going to be Roberto Cruz Arzabal. He is a PhD candidate in comparative literature and an adjunct professor in the Hispanic Literature Department in the National Autonomous University of Mexico, UNAM. He's also a widely published literary critic in Mexico. He's interested in the relations between literature and other arts, media-specific analysis of literary texts, digital literature, materiality, and contemporary poetry. He is a founding member of GEOM, the Laboratory of Extended Literature and Other Materialities, which started in 2013. So I don't want to talk too much. I'd rather hear what you guys have to say. But I do have a little bit of, I want to begin and I want to tell the story of how the project came to be. This goes back to June 2013, one of these wonderful weeks in June in Victoria, when Alex and I were taking the electronic literature course that that Sandy, Dini here, and as well as Margie Lusbrink and Davin Heckman were teaching for the first time at the HSI, the Digital Humanities Summer Institute at the University of Victoria. The course was basically one day dedicated to the history and theory of electronic literature, another day to the criticism, to the teaching, and you know, faithfully, there was one session, one of the exercises was dedicated to curating and planning an exhibit from the selection of the works to the planning process, the floor plan, and so on. And this is how No Legacy came to be. And even though the project has changed so much, we can still, even some of the selection of the works, we can still trace it back to that week in June. And by the way, so the courses are taking place again this year, just saying in case you are interested for it. As I was saying before, No Legacy, Literatura Electrónica gathers two argumentative lines, two approximations to elite production. On the one hand, a transatlantic, transnational, and translinguistic approach to bring together works in Spanish, English, and Portuguese produced all over the world, the subject of the second table. On the other hand, the topic of this roundtable, the material or archaeological view of elite, vis-a-vis the historical one. We take as our starting point Siegfried Sielinski's proposal of media, I'm quoting, as a space for action for constructed attempts to connect what is separated, end of quote. No Legacy aims to be such a space made up of the physical space of the gallery right outside these doors and a metaphorical space, a thinking tool to create new connections among the works, both print and electronic. In No Legacy, we aim to unfasten the ideas of influence and the passage from one literary movement or period to another, two of the bases of literary history, to propose instead a literary archaeology where material strata exist in overlap and juxtaposition. This is not to discount the value of the other kinds of studies, but an attempt to uncover other kinds of connections among the works as they deal with their materialities, their temporalities, and their overall conceptualizations. As Craig Dworkin says, No single medium can be apprehended in isolation. Moreover, media, always necessarily multiple, only becomes legible in social contexts because they are not things, but rather activities. The exhibit, thus, is also one of these activities. Similarly, the principle of juxtaposition that crosses the whole of the exhibit also aims to bring, blur geographies and languages that are already hard to pinpoint. More on that soon. Admittedly, this has not an easy undertaking. Many of the objects in the exhibit collection fall under and have been studied by us even, or by everybody really, following categories like avant-garde, post-avant-garde, magic realism, post-digital, and so on. The weight of a figure like Jorge Luis Borges is almost impossible to avoid. Undeniably, all of the works in the exhibit are products of their time and speak to one another. They all bear those marks. Nevertheless, no legacy as a space of action gathers the temporalities of the world circumscribed to the time-space of us in the gallery. In this way, we reframe the works out of their traditions and their times in order to connect them through these continuous relationships of analogy, tension, and coincidence. Though these kinds of relationships may appear idiosyncratic when put against systematic orderings of literature, they are revelatory of aesthetic and philosophical concerns traversing our notions of the literary. Think about Carlos Oquendo de Amat's 5 metros de poemas and J.R. Carpenter's Etheric Ocean proposing a horizontal reading scrolling. Then think about how etheric ocean simultaneous voices of the ocean resonate with the multiple voices in Octavio Paz's Blanco. Consider how George Piringer's alphabetic piece, Rui Torres's Poemas No Medio do Camino, Belén Gache's Poema de Agua, and Guillermo de Torres' Girándula make our eyes, head, and hands thrill in order to read them. Be fascinated by the various ways in which David Herms and Jim Andrews put the infinite into practice. As a physical space, no legacy is an intervention of the library setting and of the place of electronic literature in it. We move away from a computer or media lab, the art or museum gallery, and the classroom in order to both claim the library as a place for electronic literature and to bring the works in close proximity of the traditions from which we seek to disconnect them and reconnect them back again. The wood displays, beautifully created by Stephanie Lee and her design team, play along the ideas of operability and interoperability of the digital media. The raw and organic feel is the backdrop to displace them from the slickness of digital media. The exhibit intends to encourage visitors to draw their own connections. Located in the heart of the library, we ask visitors to reflect on the place of electronic literature within or without the always amorphous notion of the literary. We purposefully avoid references to literary movements, hoping to set the ground for them to look at coincidences based on the work's materialities. As you will see, the works are put together according to the ways in which they enact or put into practice the idea of endlessness and labyrinth, discontinuous time, the life of the typographic characters, and the back and forth of page, screen, and page. And without further ado, I would like Dene to talk now. Thank you very much.
I'm delighted to be here, and I thank all of you for coming on this rainy morning. I'm not used to rain in California, so this is a surprise. I'm from Portland, Oregon area, where it rains all the time. My students thought I was going on vacation today. I've been writing to them about the rain, but thank you so much. And it's amazing. I've been curating electronic literature for a long time, and this is probably the most beautiful show, well thought out show, conceptualized show I've ever seen. So I want to congratulate both curators. And I can tell you, I know the kind of work that it takes to even just think about the pieces you're selecting, much less fabricating all of the materials to go with this beautiful organic look that has been brought to this work. So it's just absolutely stunning. So Stephanie, your group has just done a great job. So thank you so much. My job today, I think, is to talk about, to tease you a little bit about the notion of legacy. And so the title of my presentation, I'm not really going to read a paper, I'm just going to talk through some ideas with you. And that is, yes, ELIT has a legacy at No Legacy, right? So I'm going to be talking a little bit about that. And I want to start with just a definition of electronic literature. I think a lot of you have had a chance to walk through the exhibit briefly. I mean, you've not had a chance to study it. It takes some time to work through the pieces and understand it. But I thought I'd start by just giving you an explanation, if you've not encountered electronic literature before, to tell you what it is, right? There's a lot of definitions, and even the board members squabble about what we're going to call it, essentially, but most of us agree that it's born digital literature. It's work that's meant to be experienced through a computing device of some sort, right? That's at the heart of what we are talking about. And it's in a really interesting form because it's a natural, most of us see it as a natural outgrowth of literary experimentation that's been taking place for thousands of years. I'm a Greek scholar by training, so I can say this with some authority, that print literature has been around for 500 years, but there was a whole legacy before that, that print literature innovated, right? So I'm a Homeric scholar, and I just imagine when I was a graduate student what Homer might have said, or the Homeric poet, her or him, might have said when he or she saw the work written on paper, because that was an innovation. And I imagine scholars might have had a heart attack about that, right? Some oral scholars. So what we're doing with electronic literature is very much coming out of that desire to innovate. This is a new medium. This thing that we've got here that's not going away. It's not a fad. It's not a trend. It's here. So artists for a long time, for 40 years or more, have been playing. As long as there's been computing devices, people have been playing with this to make art. Right? That's at the heart of what's interesting, I think, for me as a scholar. So it's a natural outgrowth. And so it really does align well with digital humanities, electronic literature organization is the organization I represent, DHSI, where we teach this material. There's a natural outgrowth. I also have curated shows at ISEA. So those of you who are artists might be familiar with the International Symposium on Electronic Art. We're aligned with them, with the International Digital Media and Arts Association. There's a lot of places that we play with. And library people usually love us because we love libraries. Just to show you some examples, this is just four examples of thousands of works that exist around the world, right? So we see that it's coming to us in forms of mobile. So this is Spine Sonnet by LA artist Jody Zellin. We have what we call flash or kinetic poetry narrative. This is Samsung by Young Hai Cheng Heavy Industries, a Korean-French team that have produced some award-winning works that have sometimes been shown as net art, sometimes crossing over to electronic literature. We all claim them because we like it so much. And then the early works by Shelley Jackson, here's Afternoon of Story, Stuart Malthrop, whose work is portrayed out and displayed out in the exhibit. These are works that are hypertext literature, hypertext narratives, poetry. You probably might have heard those terms. What's astounding to me, I've been involved in electronic literature since 1991, essentially. I studied with Stuart Malthrop's now wife, Nancy Kaplan. And I was introduced to Stuart, Michael Joyce, and that whole group when I was a graduate student. I began collecting their work and meeting them and seeing them at conferences. And what's interesting is that through these years of seeing the Electronic Literature Organization take shape under the supervision of Kate Hales, Margie Lusenbrink, and folks like that, this spring alone, we have three major exhibits in the world of electronic literature. This is a zeitgeist. I mean, it's a time when it's just exploding. We have graduate students writing dissertations on this. We have so many. I mean, we're trying to count the books this morning at breakfast. There's so many books. We have an ELO prize that we're giving out now for the best literary work and the best scholarship. The field is on fire. And these are three shows, one that took place, it's taking place now in Barcelona. One that is taking place at Rutgers and the one here. These are three major exhibits that complement the many that have been taking place for the last 15, 20 years. The work I've been doing is to document this work, because as you know, when you walk around and you look at that art, somebody's got to make sure that stuff lasts for generations to be able to talk about it. As a Homeric scholar, it's nice to have Homer in writing so that we can indeed have Homer. If it was left to oral culture, we would not have much left of Homer's Odyssey or Iliad. So someone's got to document this work. So that's the work that Stuart, who's here on this side, the bottom right, and I've been doing with our Pathfinders project. But there's lots of projects that have been taking place, a whole legacy of projects that Leo is going to be talking about today, Sandy's going to be talking about. There's so much taking place right now that it's exciting to be part of this this area of study. This is a shot from my, I have 200 works of electronic literature in my private collection. I've been collecting since I was a graduate student. This is the cabinet that contains them. I'm now working to put them in fireproof containers so that they will last longer than in a wooden case. This is the lab that it sits in. There's labs popping up all over the United States that are there to experience the work. Works that are obsolete on traditional, now current computer systems. And this is my lab. It's called the Electronic Literature Lab. I have 47 Macintoshes dating back to 1977. I have every system platform that is needed to read the works that exist that I know about. And there are other works, other labs as well. This is Lori Emerson's Media Archaeology Lab at UC Boulder. And she's looking at a lot of different hardware, but she is also collecting electronic literature as well. There's a lab at MIT, at the University of Maryland, and they're collecting Dina Larson's work and Bill Bly's work. At the Duke Library, at the David M. Rubenstein Rare Book and Manuscript, they're collecting all the papers for Judy Malloy, Stephanie Strickland, Rob Kendall, and Mez Breeze, which is a very exciting thing. And at Harry Ransom, they've got Michael Joyce's papers. At Stanford, they have Judy Malloy's papers there as well. There's a lot of her materials that they've got. And MoMA collects Judy Malloy's work, her art pieces, which I think are interesting to think about, which brings me to the topic of how things develop, right? So quickly, as one example, and I use Judy Malloy because she is a Bay Area artist, and she had spent time in Berkeley. So she's your native daughter, so to speak. And I like that, native daughter. And this is one work by her called Uncle Roger that began in 1986 as a serial novel for The Net. So how many of you know The Well? Heard of The Well? She delivered this over The Well a few episodes a night from December 29th of 1986 to January 30th, 1987. And then they asked her to create, The Well folks asked her to create an interactive narrative, which worked as a database. And that developed during about the same time she was delivering the serial novel. Then she created a box version for exhibits, which I have one of five copies that's left in the world, which is exciting to have. She created then a PC version because a lot of folks in this period of 1988 were jumping over to PCs and away from Apple products. Then she created in 1995 a web version, and then she's got a DOSBox emulator that's available now that you could experience kind of the experience of the 1980s. So it has the sounds of the computer whirring and the beeping and the booping and all that stuff that happened with the early computers. I wanted you to see this to see the morph, the way it has morphed through time. And then just to finish this up, she had produced a version that was an analog version. This speaks to the crossover between the fine art practice and the literary writing that she did. So many of us, you know, Amrith is an example of this, that come out of this kind of, I want to call, hybrid experience of fine art practice and a keen creative writing, you know, sensibility, bringing those two elements together to create works like this. And this is Uncle Roger, that's this piece here in analog form as a card catalog. She created a whole variety of these starting in 1979, and these are documented at the Duke Library. Here's another one from 1980, 1985, and then we get Uncle Roger in 1986 on the computer. So the leap was not so much of a leap across a major gap. It was a nice kind of methodical move to the new medium. I want to end by just mentioning a couple of interesting things to think about as scholars, right? I'm always interested when I work with postdocs and graduate students, you know, the kind of methodologies and theories that we use in this field. And it's really a combination of traditional humanities, which is what I was trained in originally, and this DH kind of theories and practices and methods. And I have them listed here, some of them listed here, textual analysis, which I used with my study of Homer's texts, which I used in the study of Judy Malloy's text. There's an image from one of the notebooks that I got when I was at the Rubenstein. Media-specific analysis, looking at something like this and understanding the affordances of that medium and what the artist could do with it, because that's where real genius comes in, right? How you can really play with the affordances and the constraints. Close and deep reading practices, platform code studies, and then translation studies, which I'm also trained in. So those are just some of the theories and methods. So this field has taken hold. It's spread across the of the world. We have an electronic literature organization meeting this coming summer, and we have 250 people coming to this conference and festival. And every continent is represented except Antarctica. So that's my next place I'm going to go, is Antarctica, and get some scientists there. But we have something like 27 countries coming to this conference to give papers and to show art in this field. So it's an exciting time, and it's an amazing show to bring into the history and the legacy of our field. I want to thank you all for having me here and letting me talk for a second. I'm going to end, just one more thing I want to say. This came this morning at 6:30 from Joe Tabby. We're so close to having an integration into disciplinary practices, administrative needs. We also now have a credentialing document that has gone through the MLA and has essentially been blessed, that we're using now to give to departments for helping people get tenure and promotion in the field. So this has been worked on for about a year. Came this morning just in time for this talk. So I want to thank you all for having me.
Day, thank you. It's a great honor to me to be here with Alex and with Élika and everyone else. It's such an honor. And I'm going to read some notes on the intersection between archive and materiality. These are some notes I was thinking days ago, and because my English is not so good to improvise, I prefer to read this one. I hope so, no, to take many time. One, an object meets another object. Well, I have to say that I'm also a writer, an essay, so this is an intersection between academia and creative writing, and so on. One, an object meets another object. It doesn't touch it, but intersects it. The encounter is more than just the contact between surface. One integrates the other. Their structures collapse. It may create ruins or not, but indeed it creates a new structure, an heterogeneous and flexible one. 1.1. These objects are real but immaterial. They are cultural objects, if we understand culture as the social act of creating common images. Because of that, they are an effect of the social form and at the same time determinate. What I call objects were called discourse by some theorists of the last century, like Michel Foucault. It isn't more than an analogy, but a productive one. Gender and social class are examples of these objects. Some of them form subjects, and others form things and text. 2. The materiality of literary texts is a kind of cultural object. According to Catherine Hales, we should define materiality as the physical interaction that occurs between humans and technology and the multi-layer histories that lie within any technology of communication. For example, the materiality of a work of Elite is not just the intermedial text, nor the machine in which exists, nor the code or the reader, but the interplay of all of them, displayed in time and space. 3. Following Derrida and his classic archive fever, every archive needs for existence a consignation and a domiciliation. The first one determines that what constitutes the archive, the second one delimits what remains outside and inside of the archive. So, the archive has an origin, a double one, dynamic around itself. 3.1. Usually literary texts are part of an archive that in the past has been called literary tradition. The consignation of some texts is the field of dispute of the literary history and the criticism. 3.2. In the field of art, the museum plays the role of a consignation and preservation of the archive. It makes architecture its domain. In the field of literature, this is the role of the library. 4. The library is the result of the intersection between materiality and archive of literary texts. It is a cultural object whose structure keeps and generates the interplay that forms materiality. At the same time, it consigns and domiciliates inside it. 5. The relationship between archive and materiality in electronic literature is paradoxical. Despite the fact that materiality includes both literary texts and the machines that generate them, the inherent properties of the technology don't allow it to be consignated into the archive. In other occasions, nevertheless, those properties demand the consignation under the form of a domain. 5.1. The electronic literature collection is an archive that consigns certain number of relevant works of electronic literature, and doing so, creates a double domiciliation. The works sojourn individually in the webpage of ELO and are made visible as a whole for the visitor. The archive consigns individuals but domiciliates a type. 5.2. B.P. Nichols' first screening poem were created in a computer that doesn't exist anymore, in a programming language that is not recognized by any other machine. Their historic and aesthetic importance demand to be consigned in the archive, but their materiality doesn't allow it. Jim Andrews worked in the recovery of the poems, consigning the work into two domains, an emulator that gives us the chance to watch it and play it with the poems, and a video that documents them. 5.3. In the labs mentioned by Dean, several teams preserves the reanimates old and obsolete technologies. Because of that, some old works of Elite can be played in their original languages, in their original codes. Those labs are and are not an archive. Preserves, but it doesn't immobilize. It is the domain of a new archive and restitutes the domains of original archives. 6. The aim of the archaeology, as we learned it from Foucault, is not the pursuit of an origin nor a totality, but of a path. The political economy of the practices and the knowledge is what constitutes the arche. In the archaeology of the electronic literature, nevertheless, we need that the arche remains in the material artifact. Insofar, this isn't enough. We need to reanimate it. 6.1. In the study of the hypognesis, Bernard Stiegler says that we exteriorize even more cognitive functions in contemporary mnemotechnical equipment. In doing so, we extend the institutive materiality of the archive. We consign the expression in a machine. 6.2. In this time, this exhibition operates as a mnemotechnic apparatus. The library is not just the domain, but the agent of domiciliation. 6.3. An exhibition, says Josh D. Uberman, can be a Deleuzian war machine. 6.4. Materiality becomes the war machine against the archive. The archive becomes the war machine against materiality. The exhibition this exhibition, Without Legacy, will become the consignation of both. Thank you.
So I think we have about 5 minutes for 15 minutes for questions. If anybody would like to start, or excuse me? Oh, yes, yeah, I will. Anybody? I'm on. So the question was how to achieve the archiving of the pieces without immobilizing it, and what the approaches that we've taken for the exhibit are, as well as Indini's practice in her lab and her exhibitions. So what I can say here is for the exhibit, at the beginning, and again, this is a project that has been unfolding for 2 years, there's been many changes. So originally, we wanted to show the pieces in the computers that had been created originally, and I guess as closely as to an original as we could. Over time, we realized that the challenges to do that were many. And in many cases, in many cases, it was just impossible to do it. And even to find out what that original was. That was an interesting conceptual kind of thinking to do as well. So in that sense, I guess the approach was a little bit how looking into how they have been reinvented, how they have been relocated or reenacted into different platforms and potentialities, depending on the machines that we have, that we had available from the for the exhibit. And then from then on, when putting them together, just thinking of how they would speak to each other within the space of the exhibit. So moving a little bit away of looking into the piece itself and how it was going to live on its own, what its own life was, and what its life could be in the exhibit with the other next to the other pieces. So I guess that was the more fluid kind of approach that we ended up taking.
Yeah, so So I teach curating, and I'm teaching a course this semester in curating. And so we use, I don't know if you've heard of Vince Deacon, but he's one of my favorite curators. And he has a theory about multimedial curation, and that is looking at works as a site of liveness. Works are participatory, I call it PI, participatory, interactive, and experiential. So if you come to looking at works, especially works that are dynamic, like electronic literature, the works themselves are alive, and you put them next to each other, and they feed off each other and produce a new kind of entity. So there's this energy that happens in curating works of electronic literature. I've also curated print-based works and paintings. So I come from a training of curation for traditional art. So there is a difference when you produce this kind of exhibit than when you produce a traditional painting. Fine art exhibit. The second thing I'll mention is one of my other favorite curators is Hans Ulrich Obrisk, who talks about art as experiences. And if we think of art not as objects, but as experiences, it changes the way you handle them. So even with something like the Pathfinders Project, where we're archiving and documenting those works, we treat the works as open spaces. We have the authors perform their works on video, and then we capture those videos for the book. And then we have readers come in and perform the readings, and we have those along with the author's readings. So that's just one series of readings by three different people giving different perspectives, with the idea that that's just three of so many possibilities. That's different than saying, here's a DOS box simulator, here's Uncle Roger, this is it, because it's not it. right? It's not it.
Thank you, Dene. Mm-hmm. Yes, that's a really good question. And I guess the best example to take is Victory Garden. We had Victory Garden, Stuart Maltrow's piece, in the library collection as a floppy disk, the original from 1992. And we were delighted to have it again because we had this impulse to do it as close to the original as possible, or to a first edition, let's say, to do it, which was more in tune with their idea of a bibliographical kind of exhibit. Then we realized that there was no single computer on campus that could read it. and that prompted us to not only look into machines that could read it, but also talk to the people in the digital archiving lab. Is it a lab? Yes. In the Bancroft Library. So that was a great problem to have because it allowed us to partner with people who are at the forefront of the issue of preservation and rescuing those materials locked in their platforms. Still, we were hoping to get another a vintage machine to read it, which we couldn't get in the end. So we had to go through emulation and having a virtual machine running in the end to read it. So it's a big matter of trade-offs, really. So in the end, it boils down to what are we more interested in, bringing it to life somehow, or bringing it to life as it was supposed, I guess, kind of mummified in a way, the way it was supposed to be. So the decisions are very specific to each one of the pieces. And also by being a little bit more flexible as to what they would look in the end has allowed us to bring them to life in a different way. So Ana Maria Uribe's Annie Poemas too, which are small gifts, gift files, are going to be living in a completely different medium, which you'll be able to see later today. But just thinking about the scale of the works and how they go in tune with the smaller scale devices that we have currently as well. Thank you.
You were talking about creating an archive and creating a sort of a lively activity of an archive and an exhibit. What is the role of the visitor in an exhibit like this?
I should repeat the question, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I forgot to do it before. What is the role of the visitor in an exhibit? Would you like to begin?
Yeah.
Roberto.
Yeah, he's gonna.
Yeah.
Why don't you start? We haven't spoken.
Well, I think it's a complex role because, of course, the visitor activates the machines and the employees with the objects with the works, but also it can make relations that are not obvious in the space. When I was visiting the exhibit, for example, it's very interesting to see that electronic objects are alive, are artifacts which I can play with them, but the books I cannot. The books yes, it's very ironic, it's very paradoxical, but it's very interesting because I can see the book as an object and relate it with other books as in the Barbour's Atlas, and then I can go to the electronic devices and play it with them with the imaginary of the book and doing so. So the visitor is an activate it's like a play master, like something that I have to play with the objects and the time and the space and all the complex thing, besides the decisions of the curator.
We talk in terms of architectronics and that kind of worldview of curating. There's four things you have to think about: the space, what you have to work with, the curator's vision of what that show is going to look like, what it's going to, what message it's going to have. There's also the objects themselves, the experience of the works, and then the visitors, right? You have to design for them as well. And all four of those components have to work together. So curating is not just curating the objects, it's curating the experiences, but also curating the space, people that come into the space, and even curating your own vision. Because when I start a show, I have 1,000 different ideas. I've got to put that into some sort of order, else there's no show that makes any sense. So you're curating your own thoughts as well. So that's there's four components in any kind of work you do.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dene. Claudia?
I'm curious, you touched upon this a little bit, but you were talking about creating an intervention within the physical space, specifically within the library, which is an institution. Right now we're in a data science, mm-hmm. you know, part of a data mm-hmm. science institution. So what does it mean to bring electronic literature, sort of this, you know, traditional humanities, but also just electronic literature in general, into those institutional spaces? What kinds of contributions does that type of intervention make?
Mm-hmm. Would you like to speak?
You start.
I start? Okay, I will. then Alex can pitch in as well, yes. So the question is, why have electronic literature in a library, basically? So we do see it as an intervention precisely because of the kinds of experience that we had with electronic literature really not having a place to live in the library, as the Victory Garden example showed. The object was living in the library, but there was no way to access it anywhere in the library or in campus for that matter. So how do we bring back the idea of the literary that so traditionally and for such a long time has lived and really inhabited and filled the space of libraries, how does electronic literature move, has kind of moved outside of that because of the environments that it requires and the infrastructures that it requires. So how do we bring all of those things back? And this is a question that has always been also at the center of digital humanities approaches. How do you bring the humanities back into the library when what you need is a different kind of space that does not necessarily obey the architecture? And I mean the architecture in really broad terms, like the buildings, the spaces of the library, the power potentialities of the library too, and so on. So in that sense, we're intervening the space of the library, I guess, physically too, as you know, in the sense of bringing more power, moving the furniture, bringing new furniture in that holds not just books, or not at all books for that matter. but definitely, the idea is to make that connection, that to trace that line in between the idea of the literary that has always existed in the library, and to bring it to electronic literature. But also back again, as Roberto was mentioning before, like how do we approach these objects of books once we've been reading electronic literature too, and more conceptually again, just thinking about what is a library in the 21st century, what kind of materials does it hold, what kind of activities does it invite. And what kind of infrastructures it facilitates for the kind of scholarship and the kind of cultural production that is going to be mm-hmm. preserved and contained in the libraries currently.
Mm-hmm. My friend Nancy Tessman, who was head of all the libraries in Vancouver, just retired, but I heard her speak about it about 2 years ago before she retired. And one of the things she said was that, in her perspective, the new library was a library not about books but about information. And anything that required information, any medium that held information, was fair game for her library system. And I liked that because that meant that electronic literature fit nicely in the Vancouver libraries, and we did mount a show there for them. The second thing I'll mention is that the thing I like about electronic literature, I like about curating electronic literature more than media art, is that electronic literature, we embrace the notion of computation. It sits at the heart of what we do. We're not embarrassed about it. We're not ashamed of it. We lay it bare for all of you to see. We don't hide the computers. We may enhance them in a show like this, but we're not embarrassed of the wires and the cables and all of the mucky stuff that happens with computing. It's part of its beauty. And so I think from that perspective, that makes a difference in how we handle these objects. And because it is information, it sits in a library beautifully. So the two are so interwoven. That's why I do think the natural habitat for electronic literature is a library setting.
Yeah, it's very interesting also that an exhibit like this in a library is also an intervention not only in the space but also in time, because we can extend the life of the books and the life of the electronic literature to the past. We have like one century of Hispanic experimental literature, from the first one, avant-garde, and the late work of Eugenio Tiselli, for example. And it's very interesting because we can see that century of Hispanic experimentalism in all the media. So it's like an archaeology for the future. Mm-hmm. It's creating a new time from a physical space. And I think that's a very interesting intersection.
Thank you, Roberto. Sandy.
and I mean that also in sort of a cybernetic sense. We irritate it and it changes and so on. So my question is, clearly we want to be in a position where, as ELIT, whatever we are, scholars, practitioners, teachers, creators, that we're not constantly saying, time to intervene in the library. Or are we, right? In other words, do we imagine a different kind of library where what we do wouldn't be an intervention? Do we want to keep the language of intervention, which is a language of kind of crisis and being on the edge? Do we like that? Do you see what I'm asking?
Mm-hmm. So the question is, what is the use of using the language of intervention and being on the edge of, do we want to move past that? One of you would like to begin?
I don't think of it as intervention. I think it is a natural habitat. So I think the show is so organic because it's using wood anyway. So there's this natural kind of form that the electronic literature is taking here to represent the notion that it is a seamless connection between the library's early mission and its mission today as a site of community, of information flow, and access. Mm-hmm. So,
thank you, Dene. Roberto.
Yeah. Well, I use the term intervention. Yes, it's a warm language, also, but I think it's part of the paradox of the electronic literature, of the literature in general. Yes, the library is a common space. It's a space for preservation, but also can be a space for agitation. And I think we can put in that in front of our exhibits. It's not the only one. It's not the only thing that we can do. Of course, we have to preserve, but also I think we can agitate and we can move forward and move in the inner of the spaces. That's sort of.
And really what I could pitch in is the intervention, it's been more as the struggle that we've been going through, imagining what it would be like. And also coming back to Alex's question with the visitors, how are we going to, just thinking through how the exhibit layout was going to work with all the people walking through the hall all day long, pretty much. So it is an intervention because it we hope it will make people stop for a bit, play with the works, make their own connections, as I was saying before. But it's true. I mean, I also think it's their natural space, but does everybody think it's their natural space? And what kind of reforms in architecture, in facilities, and in thinking are going to be necessary for that to be really the, I guess, the standard?
Can I mention something about being here? Mm-hmm. We're in this beautiful space that's the Berkeley Institute for Data Science. And when I was last year, I did a curation course in London. And one of the places that we visited was the Open Data Institute, ODI, which is, if you've never visited, it's an amazing place. But they have in the space very much like this, installations of media art throughout the entire office space, which I thought was just an amazing concept. And I asked them point blank, you know, why do you have art next to your desk? You know, why is that there? And their response was, this is information. We're information. We're interested in data. This is beautiful data. This is sublime data. And we want to promote that. We want to embrace it. And I just thought that was an amazing concept. So here we are today, electronic literature in this environment. It's natural here too, right?
It's become natural anyway. Unfortunately, we're running out of time, but I'm happy to talk some more later. Thank you so much, everybody. We're going to take like 5 minutes to reorganize for the next panel. And thank you so much to Roberto and to Dini, and thank you all for coming and braving the rain. We're really excited to have you all here. Thank you so much. Hello, everyone. I think we're going to start with our second panel. Thank you so much again to everybody for being here. And right now, it is my absolute pleasure to introduce, she already introduced herself, and she requires barely any introductions, my wonderful, wonderful co-curator and really dear friend, Alexandra San Pascual. She's the official introduction. She's an assistant professor of Spanish at the University of California, Berkeley, where she teaches contemporary Spanish literature and culture, 20th and 21st centuries, and electronic literature in digital humanities. She's also part of the executive committee of the Berkeley Center for New Media. Her work explores the intersection between literature and other technologies and has been published in Spain, Mexico, and the United States in the Journal of Spanish and Cultural Studies, the Arizona Journal of Hispanic Cultural Studies, Letras Hispanas and Caracteres, Estudios Culturales y Críticos de la Esfera Digital, among others. And thank you, Alex, so much for doing all of the work, and I'll just give you the mic now.
I think the best way to do it will be to also introduce my colleagues here and then maybe more naturally go into my conversation. So I'm very happy to be able to share this roundtable today here with, I want to say also my friends, Sandy Baldwin and Leo Flores. Sandy Baldwin is Associate Professor of English and Core Faculty in Digital Humanities at the Rochester Institute of Technology. He's author and editor of 11 books, including The Internet Unconscious, winner of the 2015 Catherine Hiles Prize for Criticism. He's Vice President of the Electronic Literature Organization, and he is managing editor of the Electronic Book Review, one of the oldest online peer-reviewed journals of criticism, and editor-in-chief of the Computing Literary Book Series, the only academic book series focused on scholarship on electronic literature. His current artwork primarily focuses on activist performances and interventions in multiplayer games and has been shown around the world. Leonardo Flores is a full professor of English at the University of Puerto Rico, Mayagüez campus. And the treasurer of the Electronic Literature Organization. He was the 2012 and 13 Fulbright Scholar in Digital Culture at the University of Bergen in Norway. His research areas are electronic literature, especially poetry, surprise, and its preservation via criticism, documentation, and digital archives. He is the creator and publisher of a scholarly blogging project titled I Love ePoetry, which really is the main and most important blog about this, in my opinion. And a member of the editorial collective of the Electronic Literature Collection, Volume 3, just released, and what we'll be talking about today. I don't want to take much time away from our wonderful guests, so I will keep my intervention short and sweet, hopefully. Or I'll try. And perhaps I will start with a personal comment and a few provocative questions or theoretical positions. Firstly, I would like to explain something behind the curation of No Legacy that was not addressed directly by Élika, and that it has to do a lot with my own communicative limitations or my failures in explaining to my colleagues and friends, or even my mother, what I really meant when I was talking about electronic literature. I had been thinking a lot about ELIT, and my expressive constraints had proven to be very frustrating until I realized that what I wanted to say about ELIT could not be said with words, or not quite, or not exactly with the type of words that I know how to use in my human languages and the alphabetic languages that I speak. And it is not because English is my second language. I felt a lack when talking about digital logic, aesthetics, electronic rhetoric, different literary notions that don't belong to the realm of printed words, but don't come from the oral tradition either. I found myself seeking for a somewhat esoteric discourse about electricity that needed to be somewhat powered by light, which is the only medium that is in itself content and carrier of pure information, right? A la McLuhan. And I realized that, paradoxically, to talk about this electronic immateriality, I needed to think about its materials. If words couldn't grasp the electronic literary as a concept, I needed to make a material discourse, like this exhibit. A way of writing that trespass words and obviously languages, something very trans. But how trans is really ELIT? How transatlantic, how translinguistic, how transnational it really is? And why should we read it or not as world literature at all, right? Or why should we even think of this as a theoretical question when thinking about electronic literature in the world? And a few ideas come to mind immediately. We are dealing with a type of literature that moves easily between media, as we said in the previous panel, but also between languages, between linguistic traditions, and thus a comparative framework presents itself right away as a potential approach. Jessica Pressman has actually proposed this very successfully when she explains that electronic literature is comparative literature. It is born digital, it operates across multiple machine and human languages, and it requires translation of these languages before it even reaches us as human readers. It is procedural and computational, and it's processed across multiple platforms, protocols, and technologies in accordance with the constraints and technical specificities of hardware, software, and network configurations. E-Lit combines text, image, sound, movement, interactivity, design, challenging traditional disciplinary boundaries as well as genre categories, right? This is what Pressman says. And for these reasons and more, electronic literature requires its reader to think and read comparatively, she explains. Moving a little bit away or to the side of her, I have also proposed somewhere else that E-Lit should be or could be read as foreign language literature. Due to the interdisciplinary nature of the electronic literature field and the multi-layer qualities of the digital objects under study, E-Lit raises suspicion in English and comp lit departments, as well as media study departments, not being literary enough for the first two, but paying too much attention to literature over the latter, and this is something that Dene has said before. E-Lit is something intrinsically hybrid, going beyond languages in the sense of idiomas or technical praxis, and this hybridity allows me to position it in the foreign language department. Shameless plug here. After all, we are facing a type of literature that necessarily incorporates different semiotic languages, sound, movement, text, but also programming and formal languages, JavaScript, Perl, Python, and natural languages that can be expressed in different tongues, Spanish, Portuguese, Norwegian, English. Couldn't we think of this combination as a language in itself, a global language? There seems to be something inherently global about E-Lit. Scott Redberg and Patricia Tomasek have noticed that E-Lit's dependence on the global network has made the development of electronic literature more international in nature than any other previous literary tradition. And despite the fact that the French, the Spanish, the German, the Dutch, the Brazilian, the Scandinavian, the English, American, and Canadian, this is their list, don't necessarily speak the same languages, we're all becoming increasingly aware of each other's works. The field of electronic literature is a network of networks, Redberg says, and we're only beginning to learn how to work together. This landscape seems to assume that there is something, as I said before, intrinsically global about E-Lit, something that would make us wonder if we can, or if we even should, talk about E-Lit in different languages. Because the E-Lit community is intertwined with the global network, it has also been posed as essentially international. Yet, as Redberg and Thomas Sess remind us, it is still the case that many communities are emerging from and are responsive to national and language-based literary traditions. Under this lens, in my particular case, I wonder, what would Spanish or Hispanic E-Lit look like? What elements beyond language would be decisive for its conceptualization? And where would we locate it if talking about geopolitical frontiers in the web has long become pointless? Are we witnessing the ultimate type of world literature? One usually thinks of question of circulation and reception of works around the world when we think of world literature. And these type of words and works circulate, on the one hand, almost always in translation, which, and I'm thinking particular Spivak, have argued that this translation eliminates the linguistic richness of the original and the potential political force that a work would have in its context. On the other hand, circulation depends on the world market. Conversely, E-Lit is usually published for free, not depending on publishing houses or sales, although, of course, access now depends on different material considerations, like having an internet connection or the right software or hardware or access to it. On the web, ELIT simultaneously gets published in every location, and a lot of the time in different languages at the same time. I'm not interested in patterns of circulation per se, although the same inequalities of the global literary field that exist in the world, which our colleague from Stanford, Franco Moretti, has described as one but unequal, exist in the web, where are also present here, right, in the web and in the physical real market, where most works exist in English. Unfortunately, for now at least, although I know my two colleagues here are changing this, the map of ELIT seems to replicate the map we all know. It is broadly unglobal and it lacks diversity. Most theoretical works on electronic literature propose formal principles, and if we're lucky, with reference to communities, histories, or practices of production, but they don't come to the front of established histories or of ELIT, or are the most canonized works, as Sandy actually has noticed. Some other approaches abandon the idea of languages and geographies altogether by proposing, like Joseph Tavy has said, a new definition of the literary in relation to world literature. And I quote, "Only a redistribution of concepts, a way of thinking about the conditions of literary writing, will take us to a place, a collaborative workspace, where works by many different authors can reach a selective audience more diverse than any faction could be. Rather than attempting to produce a cross-section of world literature in new media, Tavy's approach is to advance a notion of the literary different from print-based models that are so thoroughly embedded in our idea of world literature. Other equally embedded ideas," he says, "like the grand thought of freedom and the yearning towards universality, also need to be investigated in the conception of cyber visionaries, no less than in the long-time scenarios of world literature." This is what Tavy says. "What is universal is no longer a single world vision that necessarily transcends its national, racial, gendered, or cultural origins. What is universal, instead, is the ability, by observing the constraints on the current world system as it configures itself in our actual writing spaces, to enter into meaningful conversation with other creators in written as well as non-written forms. In this sense," and I'm still with Tavy, so I like him very much, "world literature, the electronic networks that support it, and the social networks that sustain it can be regarded as an alternative formation to globalization. What is literary about world literature can be recognized in its capacity to disturb these mode operations of global communications using textual instruments whose operations are largely conceptual." And this, of course, echoes a lot of ideas about ELIT production and distribution in the web as participating within an emerging digital gift economy, an alternative model of circulation and economy. Instead, of course, one important accomplishment of electronic literature, and actually indeed one of the important accomplishments of electronic literature, may be or may have been to locate narrativity not as a literary universal, but as one of the many qualities best realized in the particular medium of print. In this sense, digital media would not be a threat to the life of books, you know, the death of the book, or literature, but would help us in our reevaluation and relocation of this very slippery term, right, of the literary in multiple media. And obviously, if you walk around our gallery, you'll notice that the relocation of literary across different media is one of the structuring concepts of this multilingual electronic literature exhibit. So then, my earlier questions emerge again. How transmedia is ELIT? How translinguistic is it really? How can we read it under a transnational framework? And well, should we even bother? With this, I hope that my partners here in crime have some sort of answers for us. So thank you so much.
Yeah, hard act to follow. Thank you so much, Alex. Technical man, can you tell me if this is working right? Am I good? All right. Thanks so much, Alex. And I'm going to have some very scattered remarks, and partly to get to talk about some specific projects, and the remarks are really sort of prefatory and minor, but hopefully following what Alex has said. I was thinking about first-generation electronic literature and naming rights. This is a phrase, as you probably know, from Catherine Hale's. Oh, it's not on. How do I turn it on? Ah, wow. Yeah, that was cool.
I can be the technical woman.
Yeah, technical woman.
Technical woman.
That's a special power. All right. Well, it says something, if you could see it. There it is. So this is Kate Hale's well-known influential formulation. She also talks about classical works, first-generation electronic literature, and this seemed to refer for her in a number of essays and then culminating in the 2012 book, Electronic Literature, which is still the only book out there of that name, Electronic Literature. This seemed to refer to works from the 80s and 90s by largely American writers in English using hypertext. And this set out sort of what electronic literature was. It implied a certain historical time frame. I mean, she talks about that first generation ending in 1995, which is sort of the rise of works on the web, eventually works in Flash, and so on. It was rooted in a particular aesthetic idea of the works that were, again, tied to hypertext and so on. It was rooted in genetic notions. These works were born digital and so on. And also in this privilege of naming that she named these first-generation works. I'm thinking of this in particular because I'm thinking of alternative legacies of Elit that go back in other directions. I mean, this is a book that I co-edited with Rui Torres, although the work is that's in it is by Pedro Barbosa and Hathaway and Amela de Castro. And these are on works from Portugal and Brazil going back decades, and we all know many other traditions. And I'm just evoking the Hales, not so much to say she was wrong, because I think she was right. This was about naming, right? When you that electronic literature, and Laurie Emerson has made this argument that in some ways electronic literature was another way of seeing it as being born was when the Electronic Literature Organization was formed in 1999, which gave a name to this. And the idea here is there would be different affiliations, different heterogeneous groupings that certainly now we recognize as electronic literature, and we're kind of under the part of our job, part of our mission is to gather those affiliations to make other histories and other arguments for what electronic literature is or could be. In this, then, I'm thinking about something that I've been working in electronic literature and digital creative writing for, I was trying to think about it, about 22 years. And people have, in the whole time that I've been working on it, there's been this question that people constantly say, why isn't there Elit in, and you can fill in that, those brackets, and I'm going to describe here what I think of as in a very naive way, as a double logic here. So typically this would be, why isn't there Elit in Uganda? Or why isn't there Elit in Bhutan? Or why isn't there Elit in wherever we want, in Chile? And these typically are questions of asymmetries, right? And I was thinking of four kinds of asymmetries here, that they're typically questions of places where different technical infrastructures. So if I ask about why isn't there Elit in Uganda, it meant, in some ways, well, because they don't have internet connections, they don't have, they don't have the software, they don't have the hardware, they don't have those infrastructures. It were questions of human infrastructures too. That meant they didn't, well, if I ask why isn't there Elit in Algeria, it's because there aren't pedagogies to address it, there aren't, people to teach the skills, this sort of thing. Memories and traditions, because it seemed to mean, well, meant they don't have the experimental tradition, they don't have the reference to all the things we think are important, Ulupo, John Barth, whatever you want. And then they don't have the context and networks in such places. In Bhutan, they don't, I'm just choosing these out of my head. In part because they're placeholders. They don't have the artist networks, they don't have the, outside of, they don't have maybe the universities to sustain this. Now, I think the big question is this question itself, right? Because it assumes that, and I think the issue of why is there no Elit is one of these formulations that is, both illuminates certain things but also obscures certain things. In other words, we go, people who ask those questions are in some ways saying, why isn't what I think Élit is visible in all these places, whatever place it happens to be, right? And there are these, and the problems again are because we've developed, because the people asking the questions have a certain technical framework in mind that they think Élit fits, right? That you must have an internet connection or you must have X, Y, or Z. Because there's also an idea of a certain human infrastructure that you need certain skill sets, you need a certain approach to writing. Again, we think certain memories and traditions that we necessarily connect to an experimental tradition, and that makes a lot of sense. I mean, I come out of an experimental writing tradition, and that when I teach about Élit, I say to students, Élit comes out of experimental writing, but that's the case for me, and that's the case for many people speaking out of this orientation, and that leads us to look for leads people to look in locations and say, why experimental writers? Why aren't you doing Élit? And the same with contexts and networks. So I think part of the question here is the very kind of thing Alex was asking about is what is both the need for organizations like the ELO and scholars at universities who have privilege and have resources to go and teach about Élit and to go and seek out Élit in other locations, but also to be prepared to completely give up on what they think these things are, and completely to say, to find things that we may not identify as Élit. The classic example is Yonghae Chang, which Dene mentioned earlier, right? Yonghae Chang has become the sort of token of Élit in East Asia, right? When people say, why isn't there Élit in East Asia? Everybody can say, there is, right? We've got Yonghae Chang. But that's, and the wonderful thing about Yonghae Chang for that argument is they clearly connect to, as Jessica Pressman has shown, connect to the tradition of modernist poetics. They fit in, they have technical infrastructures, they're doing things in Flash, they have this kind of idea of memory tradition, so they fit really well. So all that's to say that I think as this field grows both institutionally, academically, scholarly, and also as artists, we need to be prepared to also be taking apart what we build. I was thinking then, and like I say, these are really rambling things, but I'm going to try to get to a few projects here. Affiliations, communities, and translations. I'm just looking ahead to the title of the ELO 2017 conference in Porto that a number of us are already working on, and we're looking specifically in this to questions of translation, questions of affiliation, questions of community, obviously, but counter-translation, counter-affiliation, counter-community. And so then I'm just going to talk about I don't even know how long I've gone for, hopefully not too long. I'll think about this. I'm going to talk quickly about three projects that try to do this, I think, right? This, other people here have heard me talk about the cell project some. Is that going to, it's going to load? Cellproject.net. So I can talk about the cell project anyway. Yeah, I don't know which one my slides are. Yeah. Okay. Well, this is the cell project. I'll talk quickly about it. It's a ELO created, ELO initiated this group cell. And again, that's part of the kind of tense asymmetry here. So the ELO, based here in the US, based at MIT, created this organization that's intended to be the sort of global organization around electronic literature. It stands for Consortium of Electronic Literature. Currently consists of something like 10 groups worldwide, research centers who are developing online resources for electronic literature. In that sense, it attempts to grab a snapshot, a kind of global view of Élit. In another sense, it again replicates the situation because the groups that are doing it all have the resources to create big online archives and so on. It does attempt and is working on a search engine that would search across these sites, so we would have a kind of first kind of merging where we have, let's say, I Love E Poetry, which has many, many readings of works of E Poetry and other things as well, but also projects from, let's say, Germany that focus on German language electronic literature, projects from Portugal like POEX that focus on experimental writing, some of which is electronic literature,
Large projects such as ELMSIP in Norway that focus on electronic literature in any sense. So ELMSIP, you know, anything that anybody thinks is electronic literature is there. So what this tries to do then is to step above or move to a meta level to say, what do all these groups think electronic literature is? What is it globally? How can we understand it? How can we use different kinds of data mining, different kinds of taxonomization, different kinds of analysis to both look at where we agree, where we disagree, where there might be clusters of interesting things that are happening in particular languages, particular, but also very looking, we're hoping through this database, this search engine, to find unforeseen things, right? Topics that might be totally unforeseen. But again, it has the same, our countries that we participate are largely a kind of, again, places that have that kind of the resources and the infrastructure and so on. So I think this is my slideshow here, somehow. Because I'm trying to go back to it. Because I want to go back. But it doesn't want to let me go back. All right, hold on.
You lost your internet connection as well.
Is that what it is?
Go up to the top.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, it's kind of waffling, isn't it?
And see if Edgerone is there.
Air Bears.
Yeah,
what?
Fun technology talk.
Well, I can just talk some. I can talk some more. So then, I was going to talk about two other projects, trying to, from my mind, think about this in a different way. I'm leading a series of workshops in Ghana and Benin in May with colleagues from both RIT and the University of Paris-Wheat, where we're collaborating with the University of Ghana, and then some cultural institutions in Benin, to both present these as discussions of electronic literature. In other words, we're working with arts organizations in those locations as well as the universities there to say, here's what we're coming from Paris, we're coming from the ELO, we have these projects and this idea of this new art field and a kind of a tradition, but what's going on here? And part of what stimulated us was a series of encounters through some grad students working with me with then artists working in West Africa, doing, to my mind, really exciting work in using new media, largely using cell phones, also doing some Facebook work that they did not see themselves as doing either literature per se, or even ELIT. They had no awareness of what we were doing, and we're trying to find a setting where we can dialogue with them. And sort of, it's like this question of what would ELIT be in Spanish, or a question sort of was, what does it look like from West Africa? And then I was going to talk.
If you select a different network,
yeah.
Go down to Visitor.
Cal Visitor. That's. I mean, it's not.
There
it is. Well. I mean, I'm almost done anyway. But yeah, there. Okay. So I think I'm almost done. I've probably been talking too long, anyways. This is also partly sponsored by UNESCO, who have an initiative to think about what is digital humanism rather than digital humanities. In other words, what would be a new kind of humanism? They want to suggest an alternative to what they see as a kind of technocratic, instrumental idea of digital humanities. And also then, what would this mean? How would this let us think about other regions and different kinds of regional clusterings? Because again, if you look at more broadly in DH has some of the same asymmetries that I'm talking about. And then, yeah, quick, lastly, this is Arabic ELIT, which is an initiative set up by a scholar from Egypt who's organizing what seems to be the first network of Arabic language ELIT writers. She's working with me on a fellowship in Rochester for several years. And in this one, I've been trying to, I don't know much about the area. She's kind of organizing it from below. We're organizing a similar kind of set of conferences and workshops in Dubai at this point, we're hoping in Egypt as well, and then returning to the U.S. to try to bring a number of ELIT artists from those places. Again, trying to sort of say what does this mean? What do you think this is? What kind of dialogues can we set up with you to map the field in a different way and map it in a way that the U.S. doesn't feel like the biggest thing on the map. So that's pretty much what I was going to say. Thank you.
Preview. No, let's find it here then. Open with preview. There we go. All right. So, thank you for setting the tone and getting some good material out here. I want to talk about some concrete projects, a specific concrete project, the Electronic Literature Collection, which we launched just a few weeks ago. And we are still adding features and developing towards a complete sort of a distributable physical media version, downloadable version by June. As one of the editors of this collection, I worked also with Anastasia Salter, Stephanie Bolook, and Jacob Garby, who wish they could be here, and hi if they're watching. We put together, we went through this process that started in 2014. We were chosen by the ELO board and given the mission to assemble, do the call, put together this electronic literature collection. This is the third one. These collections happen every 5 years, at least have been happening every 5 years. The first one was in 2006, the next one, volume two, in 2011, and now we have volume three, which I'm happy to present. Now, in putting this collection together, we had a few questions that were raised, and I'll go through them quickly here, and then I'll go and try to respond to them in detail. What is the mission of the electronic literature collections in general, and specifically volume three? What did we want to achieve with it? How far can the ELO's network reach when making a call for the electronic literature collection? We were curious about how far we'd be able to get. Are there universal standards to assess the quality and or importance of the submissions? We come at it from a tradition that is very rooted in the U.S. And English-speaking world. And how do we strike a balance between inclusiveness and standards in our selection? So, thinking of the mission. Well, first of all, we wanted to assemble valuable works and resources for our audience. And of course, that begs the question, what is our audience, right? And we do have a global audience, but we are producing something for an organization that has its core in the United States. It's a registered US nonprofit organization, which does have an international scope. It has a board with members from Canada, France, Portugal, England, Puerto Rico. I don't know if you count that as international. We could debate that another time. But admittedly, this is an English-speaking audience, but it also a multilingual audience. We wanted to have things for that sort of diverse audience. We also wanted to produce a snapshot of the field. What is ELIT like circa 2014, right? End of 2014. So what are some of the platforms that are important at this time? The internationalization of the field and of the organization and our reach is part of that narrative, part of that historical moment. Historically important works. For example, Judy Malloy's Uncle Roger is a work that she is a pioneer in the field and has in the past decade become come into the, you know, like the field has awoken to the importance of her as a pioneer. She wasn't in any of the previous collections. She is here now, right? And emergent genres, right? What's going on? What's fresh? What's new? Even if it's a little rough, right? What's coming out? The reach. How far could we reach with our call? Well, this is the first collection in the age of social media, as we have it. There is a Facebook group for the Electronic Literature Organization. The call was widely circulated there. Other organizations, other groups have their Facebook groups, have their social networks. We advertise the call heavily in social media, email, mailing lists. We have 17 international consultants that help spread the word as well. And we went directly to communities and tried to reach them and get them to spread the call. And we received over 500 submissions, the most any of the collections has received. So how could we address those 500 works and do justice, right? How can we assess quality? Well, we admit that quality standards vary by community, but as a board composed of you know, four members, fairly young members, really, of the community, some coming from a gaming perspective, from an artistic perspective, from, you know, other perspectives. I was the old one in the team. I was the senior one in the team. We kind of agreed that an engagement with the media was important, right? A serious engagement, some sort of innovation, or at least you know, a sort of a virtuoso performance of that engagement, of that work, and significance. We wanted works that, you know, had some bite to them, that had an impact. We then had to make the decisions, right? We made an initial quality assessment in which we went through the works and we rated them in terms of, you know, yes, maybes, no's. It went beyond that. But one thing we did in narrowing that selection of over 500 works, after that initial quality assessment, we still had a couple hundred quality works, and we needed to get something closer to 60, which was what previous collections had. So we made the decision to prioritize new voices. We have very well-established people in the field who had been in previous electronic literature collections. We felt that the opening of the field to new voices, to new spaces, was important to bring in here. And so we prioritized new voices, and then works that maybe were from underrepresented countries, languages, platforms, we revisited, we reconsidered, keeping quality in mind, because we did not want to create, just represent for the sake of representing, something that maybe wasn't up to the standards of the community and the audience. The result, we ended up publishing 114 works, which, you know, is like one out of every five works. The main cluster of works, the main node, and I'll show this in a moment, contains 73 works. So the previous collections had 60 works each, all in one sort of main grid. We increased that to 73, and we had three special collections, folios, if you will, of Taroko Gorge remixes that included 16 works. Renderings, which is an Elit in translation project, and bots, that is an emergent Elit genre that we felt was important to represent. In the end, there are 26 countries represented in this collection and 13 languages, which we're quite happy with. So that's the main grid of the 73 works, and you can see the Taroko Gorge remixes, renderings, and bots here on the left-hand column, those are the folios. And if you open those, this is more or less what they look like. They're documenting these projects, these genres, this phenomena, right, that that are best appreciated collectively. So bots are one of the oldest Elit genres. If we were to really go back, we'd go back to Eliza in 1964. She's the grandmother of Siri and all these other wonderful bots that we have. But with social media, Twitter in particular, this network has blossomed. A lot of people are producing bots, creating bots, and doing wonderful things, and we wanted to get a snapshot of that. If we're to look at the author distribution, where are the authors in this collection? Well, I threw together a little heat map. The darker colors, the US, Canada, you can see England is a little darker, but it gives you a sense of where the Elit is and also where it isn't. And it's not so much because we didn't try. We did reach out to folks from Africa, from India, but they didn't have the networks. They didn't know where the work in India was, for example, that they could bring in. If we're to look at a distribution here of the countries, you can see that there's about 56 authors that reside in the US. This does not necessarily mean that they're American, so there is diversity within that. But residing in the US, we have 56 authors. That's about 42% of the authors. So that's pretty good. If we look at the language distribution, 50% of the works were originally written in English. The other half in other languages. And 17% of those have been translated into English. So, and actually many of the works are in multiple languages. But again, we tried to, the moment brought some diversity into the circumstances. Now, if we were to do a quick comparative look at the three collections, Volume 1, 2006, this is an early moment in the organization. The ELO at that time was not having regular yearly conferences. And when they started, they were bi-yearly. And now they're yearly conferences. Volume 2, which was the organization was a little stronger, a little more international. And Volume 3, which I have just presented. If we look at Volume 1, there are two categories in their keywords, multilingual or non-English works. There are 7. So that's about 11%. And authors living outside North America, which I imagine includes Canada, were 16, right? So again, it was international from the start, but we also have to acknowledge how far can we reach as editors in a call. Volume 2, we have 14 works not in English. So that's 23%. That's an improvement. One of the editors, Laura Borjas Castañer, from Barcelona, Catalunya, she I'm sure helped activate her network and bring that diversity, those new voices into the field. Volume 3, it's in the age of social media. You have a Puerto Rican who's talking to Mexicans and Peruvians and Argentinians, but you also have this wonderful social media diversity here. So we have 42 works that are not in English, 37% of the collection. And authors living outside the US, 77, 58%. So it's a step in the right direction. I wonder what future ELCs are gonna look like. I imagine we'll have more Elit created as new generations become increasingly digitally native. We'll have more Elit communities around the world, resulting in more international submissions. I think digital divides across countries, languages, ethnic, gender, and socioeconomic classes will erode as the sort of penetration of code literacy and internet networks increase. We'll have new platforms emerging. Others will mature and others will fade. Flash is fading fast. And obsolescence will continue, as will preservation efforts. So I think we have a lot of work to do. Just to think globally here, I went and looked at some statistics. Internet users in the world, you know, this kind of gives you a sense of the growth of the field, right? Internet users by region. Notice that Asia is 48% of the internet users. If you look at the list of internet countries by internet usage, China is number one, has 21.97% of the share of world internet users. At least it did in 2014 when this data was assembled. And we can see that the United States, right, the penetration is the percentage of population with internet. For China is 46%, for the US is 86.75%. I think these are telling numbers, because this elit thing, this digital creativity, is a kind of a numbers game. We need people, increasing numbers of people who are code literate, growing up with games, doing things that will be natural to them. They won't, this creativity, we just can't stop it. And it will inhabit these digital spaces. So my last few slides to kind of wrap up my remarks, points of entry for electronic literature. Media is a big vector of entry, and of course, artistic and avant-garde movements that have to do with media, concrete poetry, visual poetry, etc., enter that way, video poetry. Programming, generative literature is among the oldest in the field. So code literacy, platform literacy, generating things. Different platforms, right? Flash was a platform that allowed an entire generation of artists to produce work. I think tablets, mobile platforms, etc., are inspiring an entire new generation. Video games, of course, you start with play, but soon you're cheating, hacking, and creating, you know, deeper into this. And networks, whether they're social media networks or mobile networks or, you know, anything that allows us to come together. And what will improve these conditions and what will allow them to kind of come out and connect? Well, advanced literacy is a big part of it. Developing audiences, I think a scene, people who are moving in elit. For example, I remember visiting Slovakia, Susana Lutarova, who was published in the collection. And we went to a club, and there were some, it was techno pop, and there was language on the screen, and they were doing music with things, but there was language as part of it. I look at that, and it's like, this is elit. They don't recognize it as such. And in Puerto Rico, when I ask, you know, where's the elit in Puerto Rico? I know a handful of people, but apparently in the performance scene, there's quite a bit of language being made to dance. So, but how does it come together? How does it get published? How do these communities then organize and connect? The Cell Project is an example of how communities have become organized enough that they can connect with us. And as an organization, we need to be receptive to making those connections. Scholarship is an entire other layer, right? Brings it to universities, perpetuates the, disseminates this. And publication. And we need to think down the line about profit, whether it's direct monetary profit or in some sort of a cultural currency. So thank you. I leave you with those questions.
Digital humanism at a time when, post-humanism is also this big currency being discussed, right? And in particular in relationship to the question of both virtuality and materiality that I'm kind of assuming is also at the heart of what maybe you mean by digital humanism, I don't know. And the way that has been taken up by post-humanism and those discourses. So I was just curious because I wasn't sure what you meant.
Yeah, I'm gonna repeat the question.
Okay. Thanks for that question. The first answer is that I don't know because it's not my formulation. It's the UNESCO conference that is funding us in part. But I'll take some stabs at it. I think they intend it in relation to digital humanities, where the argument is that digital humanities, both as an outgrowth of the humanities as increasingly a site of a particular kind of cultural literacy that's tied that feeds into kind of a broader neoliberal kind of culture of the humanities in service of STEM and other things has lost the sense of the humanities as humanistic and, let's say, concerned with what's human and who different cultures are and so on, I think, right? And I think that argument is also that digital humanities has become increasingly focused on instruments and tools. So I think that's part of the thrust of it. But I do think it's very, your question is very interesting in terms of transhumanism. I'd have to speculate on that. I mean, certainly thinking of humanism as a mobile kind of set of orientations towards others that would try to interrogate national boundaries in the era of, let's say, vast refugee flows, right, where, you know, digital humanities doesn't necessarily take that up. Those directions, but I don't think, you're also asking about, what I also hear in your question is transhumanism, which for me invoked for a long time this kind of, the uploading question and or downloading question, whichever way you go, and the kind of post-human body question. I don't think we're thinking about that necessarily. I think if we would, we might also then ask what is embodied digital practice in these regions we're looking at. So I think again in the work in Ghana, we are interested in how artists and writers in Ghana and people who don't think of themselves as artists but who are writing are embodying and thinking of their lived embodiment in new and different ways in terms of digital networks that might function quite differently than the way my students do at RIT, let's say. So I think that's if I were to go into the post-human part of digital humanism, that's where I might go, but I haven't thought of it yet. So thank you for that.
Thank you so much. This is a great morning. Dr. Flores, I wanted to know if the graphic you showed of the literature from different countries counts literature from different countries that's translated twice, once in its original language and then second in its English version, which would bias it towards more diversity than it really happens. But then I also am more interested in the readership of those materials, the circulation, if in fact the readership is mirroring the authorship or if it's different.
I did both. I did an initial sort of rough chop that presents the multiple languages, and it did show that bias, and I tried to separate the works that were translated into English and the ones that were written in English. I also did a sort of a manual count of those works. So, you know, there is diversity, but we're not all there, all the way there, right? So really what we have is a 34% of works that were not written in English, even though they may be translated into English, and many of them are. Okay. So that's the real number. and which I actually presented in one of the slides. Now, the readership. This is the first collection that actually has some Google Analytics kind of tracking data. We're actually gathering data as to where are readers. I would love to answer this question again in a year, but from the outset, the readership has been global and rather massive. From my own I Love ePoetry project, which I launched 4 years ago and have been tracking data since then, I'm shocked by the kind of international readership that I have. So from all over, people are interested in this, and they are, they're avidly reading. So with a project like I Love ePoetry, I receive about between 3,000 and 4,000 hits per month. It's not like web rock star or anything, but it is significant. It's a whole different scale.
Hitting that site since we launched it on June 1st. And it's interesting to look at the data because about 60% is coming from the U.S., but 40% from the rest of the world, which is really amazing. And it's not just universities, but it's libraries, government offices. And I can track it almost down to where they're sitting in the universe, which is really fascinating. But it's scary. But it's exciting to see that kind of growth in our field, right? And I suspect in 5 years, we're going to see even more of a shift away from U.S. in English to other countries. That's the direction we're going right now. As we build our board and add more folks from outside the U.S., we're seeing that have great impact.
I just wanted to add one quick comment on the question of translation in the ELC, which, as Leah's pointed out, has been massive and impressive, amazing undertaking. There's a lot of what's interesting for me to see is there's a number of this is through the CEL project. We see a number of the research centers are looking at translation and the kind of complexities of translation, and especially because the ELC collections have concentrated heavily. The issues often: do we translate the work into English? And there's also a lot of work being done on how do I take English language e-literature and translate it into French, Polish, whatever it is. And as we start to move both ways, we start to get a kind of practice of translation with e-lit and a kind of the issues of the challenges and also start to see kind of in some ways, again, I think for me, how so how the reference point is for so often been English language works. And as we start to move into other languages, we start to get a better sense of this kind of thing. So I just wanted to mention some of these different efforts. I quickly would be shouting out to NT2 in Montreal, and also the people at Perry Weed in Paris who've been working on, and also people in Poland. All these groups are translating English language works into other languages and setting that kind of practice out.
Thank you so much for all of your presentations. I have, I guess, two kind of comments or questions. One is I feel there is a shared optimism in the electronic literature world that this thing is expanding and that more people are going to be using it and like we're moving forward, right? And I wonder how you relate that optimism with the feeling the rest of the literature world feels we're in a crisis, right? Like less people are reading, less people have time to have quality engagement with things. The question of increasing access to resources is questioned, right? Like we don't even know if the planet is gonna be able to sustain this technological expansion with all the minerals and materials and waste that it produces, right? So there's an ecological dimension, there is the economic crisis, right? So I just wonder to which dialogue or like how this is problematized in electronic literature. And the other question is, in the last presentation, I thought it was really interesting that the big boom, because it's related, right, is like China, right? China is using, like, the big increase in the use of the internet and technology is the Asian world. And so when you've been talking about international or worldly electronic literature, and I was thinking about Alex's problematization about languages in that, right? Do you have non-Indo-European languages thinking about electronic literature, because language functions in a very different way, right? So how does someone living in China, in Japan, in Thailand interact with this? What kind of language and literature is produced? And in your collections at the end, do you have incorporated that kind of, or are we talking about Spanish, English, French, like European language-speaking world interacting with the media? Because, I mean, I'm very curious to know what it would look like, electronic literature in China, for example. Right.
Okay. Thank you, Blanca. There were like 10 questions in that, so I'm going to start answering one, and then I'm going to move on. So, and perhaps related to that idea of the crisis of literature, print literature, no one's reading, blah, and then the yay, everybody's doing e-lit, and it's great, right, type of question. And I guess it has to do a lot of, well, the question is really what is reading, right? And what we kind of, or how we value it, and how we hierarchy, or how we sort of categorize it with hierarchical values. And that the fact that for the longest time, because we've been using print, we've also valued that idea of spending a long time with one object, right? And thinking, well, deep attention is needed, and this is how we should read, and we should train people to do this, and we should, you know, we have all this free time also, right? We think of the evolution of print and the novel and the sort of bourgeois environments where it developed, right? This response to that. And then now thinking, well, rereading in a different way. It's scattered, it's, you know, and so maybe you can call it hyper-reading or surface reading, or you're scanning, and somehow we feel, but that's not as serious, or that's not as good, right? That's not, because you're not engaging deeply with it. And so you can't have a complex thought with that, right? And that's the type of thought we should have. Well, I mean, maybe my question is, like, maybe we shouldn't, right? Maybe we should just stop putting them in categories and numbering one as, you know, above the other, and then just thinking they're different models. And maybe there are also different logics of reasoning that come with different media, right? And so then we shouldn't be talking about a crisis of literature or reading, it's just that they're two models, right? And maybe one now is more suited to a different way of thinking. Now, I'm not going to go into what ideologies or economies are attached to each one, and you know how I feel about it. But I think that's one way of approaching it to start. Now, as how Chinese electronic literature looks like, I'm just going to pass on.
Well, we have at least two works from China. One of them in the renderings project, which is translated into English, but provides access to the original. So I invite you to go check it out. I'm quite curious, and I am also ill-equipped. I do not know Chinese. I wish I did. But I think for us to actually reach that, we need to get there. We need to bring scholars. We cannot expect to represent their electronic literature. I think that would be almost a colonialist move, right? A colonizing move, and we want to resist that. We want to invite and to have conversations. Now, the other thing in terms of electronic literature and its growth, I think it's a wonderful growth and a movement. It is also not what is driving the technological development. There's no money in e-lit, and money is what's driving all of these increasing networks. Now, we are and there are many problems with this sort of growth, environmental, ethical, etc. However, inside of all that, and inside of all the problems that brings, there is also a blossoming of creative uses of the word in those spaces. So I think electronic literature is an important and necessary, almost inevitable side effect to this shift to the digital. And I don't think it's going away. It's only increasing. So we're not the problem, and we're not the solution, but we are a happy accident or a happy, inevitable impulse?
I really like the question. I like the aspect also that you pointed to problems of resource consumption and kind of extermination. It would be, I think we do need to keep in mind a horizon of where we might stop reading or stop having any literature wouldn't even be a word anymore. And you know, I think I appreciate, I think we all appreciate being reminded of kind of inherent of optimistic claims, right, or utopias, and it might be, you know, this ideal of remapping. One of my questions was sort of like this idea of, well, if we look at, let's say, Zimbabwe and say, why isn't there elit there? And no matter what we do, we find less. Maybe it'll dry up everywhere, right? And that is sort of I think something we need to kind of hold as a possibility. I did want to quickly say, in working with West Africa and Ghana, because I was thinking of non-Indo-European languages, they have a practice of Adinkra, which are before the adoption of English, using a different kind of symbol systems that have kind of complex cultural meanings. They're ideographs, right? And there are people doing, they're not calling it lit work, but animated works using those. And there's also interesting work in the African, in the Arabic elit world using, again, Arabic language works, where you often have to come up with interesting solutions because so many of your software, so much of the software you use is so tied to the English language. So a lot of it's video work, right? Because with video, I can video, you know, morphing Arabic work. But you do have the one piece, which is he does. What does he do? This sort of alternative language programming system in Arabic, right? Yeah. That's in the ELO ELC, and that's really interesting because he's been directing. What is his last name?
Ramsey Nasser.
And he's been directly addressing the kind of Indo-European bias of programming languages, of platforms, of all this sort of thing.
Yeah. And if there's a burning question, we can address it. Okay, Selena. And
I'm pretty new to e-literature, but I wanted to get your opinion. Do you consider memes electronic literature? Yes or no, and why? And is there a thing or a place where you can say, okay, this is not electronic literature anymore, you know? So,
my answer is everything is electronic literature. Just like if you decide something is art, right? And that's the point. This is the point of enunciation. I'm just like playing with it, but I'm gonna let them actually answer because I don't anthologize or categorize or I curate a show where I have wood that I consider it's electronic literature. So yeah.
Well, I'll be quick too. I say yes, and I you know, and why not? But also, I think because they use language, they operate, they activate memory precisely as a meme, right? But a kind of literary memory, you know, literary memory always has both a passing on of a topos, of a space of literary context, but also an erasure of literary context, which is what literature always does, and memes do that too. So for me, that works pretty well.
Yeah, I love memes. I would say definitely yes. Part of what's interesting about them, that's why I ended it on a meme, saying you're already writing elit, is because that is one of the points of entry for an entire generation of young users who are, instead of writing on the empty page, are writing on images or writing on GIFs or GIFs, however you want to, you know, or comics, or so and they're activating them, they're writing on media, they're often pulled from media products that come from artworks, right, that television, film, whatever, that have their, in Spanish we call it a pie forzado, they have a language, you know, like a call and response, you know, what if I told you, it's a reference to the Matrix, to, I mean, it resonates, right? It contains a lot of baggage, and writing on that space is, and writing in interesting ways on that space, I think is something that the current generation of millennials or digital natives or whatever you want to call the current generation, they're doing it and massively. And I'm excited to see what great things might come from that and what it might lead to next. I think memes are a gateway elit. Yes. Why not? I'm interested to see what the ELC 4, 5, and 6 will be like. And yeah. We have several fanfic works there.
I think these are really important questions because there are certainly internal debates in the field that say certain things cannot count, right? That a digitized version of what have you, of Wordsworth, does not count. And I personally would not legislate on that as much as see those as boundary cases that need to be debated, because I think that's the case, that's how literature functions, that every time I say someone rewriting a chapter of Don Quixote is not literature, right, Borges tells me it is, right? So, you know, this sort of thing, but also because, we as a group run the danger of cordoning it off and creating a new kind of boutique. And I think rather we need a kind of very flexible, maybe almost rather than an ontology, we need a kind of series that keeps moving. So.
Mm-hmm. And with that, we end. Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. And I want to remind you all that the actual big opening, because this was just a teaser, really, it's at 5:30 at the Morrison Library, and we're going to have a very different approach to electronic literature, which is with two artists presenting their work to us and their views, Domenico Chiappe and Amaranth Borsuk. So please come, and I'll see you later.
Oh,
thank you.
Don't think we have presents.
Oh, for them? Great. We can just have them. Well, really?